This week, our castaway is the actor, Gregory Peck. Is music an important thing in your life, Gregory?
Oh, yes. I've always loved music, and we have it on more or less constantly. My wife and I have somewhat different tastes. She has her music box, and I have mine. Mm-hmm. But some of the things that I've asked you to play do mean a good deal to me. Yes, I do love it very much.
Have you ever sung on stage or screen?
I once sang in a musical in Summer Rep many years ago, badly.
What was it?
It was a Sheridan piece called La Duena, and it was modernized, and it was destined to be a Broadway musical, but it closed in Cape Cod. But a few years ago, I had a notion that I would be just the ticket for the screen version of the Don Quixote piece, The Man of La Mancha. Mm-hmm. And so I went to a coach, and I worked for 4 months on those songs, the difficult songs, yes, by the way. And I made a recording, and I sent it off to the producer and the director, who by that time were in Rome preparing the production. And the message that came back was that I had done quite well for a man who had never sung before and had only studied for 4 months. But after all, they'd found that singer-actors made out better in the piece than actor-singers. So, regretfully, they declined my services in The Man of La Mancha. And then, of course, Peter O'Toole played it. And I have great love and affection and respect for Peter O'Toole, but I tell you, here and now, I can sing better than Peter O'Toole.
Let's have the first record you've chosen for the island. What's that?
It's the Beethoven 7th. Mm-hmm. It's the third movement.
Thank you.
The third movement, the Presto, from the Beethoven 7th Symphony. Why did you take that?
It's so full of life, so full of joy. I often think of the late cutouts of Matisse, the figures that are dancing with the joy of life. I think of that as I listen to that music.
Well, that record will also remind you of home because it's the Los Angeles Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Zubin Mehta. You are a Californian by birth, of course.
Yes, I come from a little place. It's usually pronounced over here La Jolla, but by the locals it's pronounced La Jolla because it's the Spanish, and of course it's the same J that you find in Jesus.
How far back do your American roots go?
Well, my grandmother came from County Kerry. My father was born in America, but as his father promptly died, an American of English descent by the name of Samuel Peck, my grandmother couldn't make out in the New World, and so she took my father as an infant back to Ireland, where he lived for the first 10 years of his life in a place called Dingle, County Kerry. And then they made it back again to the States. But as a result of those early years, my father carried the Irish accent all of his life, and he always referred to me as my son, the film star.
That's nice. He, of course, was a pharmacist. Did you have any medical ambition?
I did for a while, and I think because it would have pleased him.
Yes.
But I wasn't much good at it, I found, and I soon switched over to literature and history and psychology and such things as that.
You were in military school, then you went to Berkeley. You were a rowing man. You'd started in San Diego Rowing Club, I believe.
Yes. I was long and lean, and that seemed to suggest that I might be able to pull an oar.
Yes.
And I did take that up, and I continued in the University of California, where they had very respectable crews. In fact, won the Olympic championship twice, not when I was there.
But you rowed at Poughkeepsie, which I suppose is the equivalent of our Henley.
Yes.
How did acting come into your life?
Well, during the last year of college, I was approached on campus. I was striding about in my longness and leanness with my crew sweater with a giant golden C on my chest. And the director of the college theater came along and said, "I need a tall actor. I have nothing but short actors." And that was the first time in my life that it had ever occurred to me that I might be on the stage in front of people.
It's unusual for a rowing man to double in theatricals at university.
Yeah, I was the only one that I knew of, yes. But I don't know why I said yes to him. I had been to some of the plays, and I'd taken note that the girls were pretty and attractive on stage. And something in me, some instinct for play acting, playing the game of pretend, appealed to me. I liked doing it, and during that final year in university, I think I appeared in 5 plays, and I wasn't any good in any of them, but I thought I detected a slight improvement. And so when I graduated, having previously thought, well, I might write, I might be a journalist, or there might be some form of writing I could handle. But here I had the diploma, and my mind was not made up. And on an impulse, more or less, I took off for New York to become an actor.
What did you do for spending money?
In college, in New
York.
Well,
in college, I know you had been a janitor.
Yes, true.
What were you
in
New York?
Other things as well. In New York, I had very little money. But then I didn't know anyone else who had any money either, so we were all quite cozy together. We borrowed from one another. I did odd jobs. I guided tours at Radio City. I was a barker at the World's Fair in 1939. I did a bit of modeling. I'm not proud of that, but I modeled for the mail order catalogs. I used to get $25 a day for leaping in and out of 200 or 300 different outfits, from long underwear to overcoats, and none of them fit, but there was a man who was very handy with safety pins behind me all the time, pinning me up so that I could jump in front of the camera, and it appeared that the clothes fit me. Other odd jobs, and then I borrowed a good deal, and 2 very fine ladies who ran a dramatic school, well known in New York, called the Neighborhood Playhouse, somehow, after I'd done an audition, believed that I might have a future, of sorts, and they gave me free tuition. And indeed, when I was really broke, I could always go up and borrow $5 or $10 from them.
Well, good for them. Let us break off now for your second record. What have you chosen?
Well, the prelude to La Traviata is an extraordinarily beautiful piece, I think.
Prelude to Verdi's La Traviata, the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. What was your first paid engagement in the theatre?
Well, I went to a very strange place in Virginia when I was about 22 years old for the summer, and the pay was board and room. And the board, such as it was, came in at the box office because it was toward the end of the Depression, and the locals were mostly farmers. And instead of money, they bartered things that they grew.
Ah, the famous
for tickets to the
theater,
the barter theater. And they actually brought in piglets, quarts of cottage cheese, bales of spinach, and whatever it was. There were fresh corn. And that's what we ate. And whatever that was there was what we had. And until you've had spinach and cottage cheese for breakfast for a week at a time, you can't really appreciate what an exotic breakfast that can be.
Yes.
But nevertheless, we did eat and we did work, and I played in 10 plays in 10 weeks. Mm. That was a good experience. Lost weight, but it was good tryout, good chance to get your feet on the stage in front of an audience, and we weren't very good, but we tried very hard.
And what was the first engagement when you were paid in dollar bills rather than spinach?
Oh, I finally got a job in a summer theater, I think the next summer. And it was at a place called Suffern, New York. And I think they paid me $25 a week. And I played bits and supporting roles. Mm-hmm. I remember playing in The Male Animal with Jose Ferrer and Uta Hagen. I had a line or two. And the show that the Royal Shakespeare has revived with such great success, Once in a Lifetime, early effort of Kaufman and Hart, dating about 31, I think. We played that,
mm-hmm.
And I had a small role in that.
You then had about a couple of years with Guthrie McClintock and Catherine Cornell.
Yes, I did. They came to see the final audition play at my drama school. That was a custom that agents and producers and professionals would be invited to see the final production of our two-year training course. And the next morning, we all gathered by the telephone receptionist back at the school to see if anyone would get a professional call. And the phone rang, and the receptionist covered the speaker and nodded at me. Apparently the call was for me. And something was said, and she covered the speaker again and said, "Guthrie McClintock wants to see you this morning." Well, I knew where Guthrie McClintock's office was because I had been in there and registered and let them know that I was in town and available for work. And it was exactly six blocks from the school. So I took off, and I ran down four flights of stairs. I ran half a block across 46th Street to 6th Avenue. I ran four blocks up 6th Avenue to 50th, dashed into the RKO office building. There was an elevator waiting. Pressed the button for the 8th floor, shot to the 8th floor, down the hallway. Mr. McClintock's office door was open. It was a Saturday morning. He was there alone. And I skidded into his office, and he was still talking to her on the phone. And he saw me, and he began to laugh. And he slid right off of his chair onto the floor, still laughing. And when he pulled himself together, he said, "You've got the job."
Well done.
And that was a small part in the Doctor's Dilemma with Miss Cornell, and a nationwide tour. So, again, I was able to get some experience with very, very good people.
Yes, indeed. And your first Broadway appearance?
It was The Morning Star by Emlyn Williams. And it had been a success in the West End, and it had to do with the Blitz. And it was quite a good play, but the Americans were not yet involved. And this kind of sentiment and even the kind of humor of the Blitz didn't register with the New York audience. So we got good reviews, and even I got good reviews, as green as I was. But the play closed after a month, to my regret.
You very speedily became a hot property on Broadway. In fact, you were summoned to Hollywood for a test after your first few plays.
Well, the test was made in New York and not in Hollywood. And I don't know why I agreed to do it, because I had absolutely no interest in pictures. I think some agent persuaded me that it couldn't do any real harm and I might have a look at myself on the screen. But I never did, and I wasn't taken up. No offer was made, and I forgot about it. And I didn't see that test until about 35 years later. It turned out to be in the archives of the Selznick estate, and the son of the late David O. Selznick, Danny Selznick, called me one day and he said, "We've discovered an early test of yours. Would you like to look at it?" I said, "I'm not sure that I would." And he said, "Well, we want to dispose of this old stuff, so we'll send it over." And he did. And one day, 35 years after the fact, I looked at it, and then I knew why. I hadn't had any film offers. It was ghastly.
There was a time when you turned down an MGM contract.
Well, I did later on, yes. The L.B. Mayer wanted me to join his family of stars, and although I come around to the idea that I'd like to make films, I was determined not to be in the MGM family of stars. To be exclusively signed with anyone. And so I was fortunate enough to witness LB's great crying act, which he put on for my benefit in his grief that I wouldn't join his family of stars and let him look after my career. And he did actually cry and carry on at a great rate.
Convincingly?
Very convincingly. At least I was convinced. But when I left the office with my agent, I said, "I haven't seen such a performance since the Luntz." And he said, "Oh, he does that every day. He loves to do that."
What, in fact, was your first film?
It was called Days of Glory. And it was with the ballerina, Tamara Tumanova. Mm-hmm. And someone had the right idea of making a feature film with all unknowns, people who had not been on the screen before. Didn't turn out to be a very good idea or a very good film.
Your second film, Keys of the Kingdom, for that you were nominated for an Oscar, which was good going.
Well, I played that story with such utter, overwhelming sincerity that it seemed to make, and with very little skill, I must say, but it seemed to make an impression on people. I had not much film technique, but I did believe in the character and in the story, and threw myself into it, and I must say I had enjoyed the whole procedure, and I began to drop my prejudice against film, and I suppose along about that time I began to become less interested in theater.
somehow or other you managed to get yourself signed up to make 14 pictures, although you'd turned down MGM.
Well, that was a kind of masterstroke of Leland Hayward. He was probably the best-known agent in Hollywood, and he had such people as Garbo and Ingrid Bergman and Joseph Cotten and illustrious clients of that sort. But he was married to Margaret Sullivan, and she took a dim view of his being an agent and thought that he ought to climb up another rung on the social and theatrical ladder and become a respectable Broadway producer instead of a flesh peddler, as she called him, to his face, I believe. So I think it was rather like a final stroke of hyperactivity and the total synthesis of his genius as an agent, he signed me up for 14 pictures with 4 different studios and then left town.
We'll get Peck bound in chains. Let's have another record. What next?
I think we'll have Duke Ellington, Satin Doll.
Duke Ellington Orchestra, Satin Doll. Yes, you had 14 pictures to make. You made 2 at once at one point.
Well, they overlapped. The Yearling was a film in which I was a Florida cracker, a backwoods farmer. And Duel in the Sun was a Western, which Mr. Selznick had decided to make. And as The Yearling ran overtime and Duel in the Sun was ready to begin, for a few weeks I did find myself bicycling from one studio to another and switching from my southern cracker accent to my Texas Oklahoma twang as a cowboy.
One of your early films I remember with pleasure was Spellbound with Ingrid Bergman for Hitchcock. How did you get on with Hitchcock?
I got along very well with Hitchcock. People say that he browbeats actors, and he's often quoted as saying, well, actors are cattle, and when you film, it's a matter of herding the cattle into the corral. The real work is done in the planning stage before we ever go on the floor. But, you know, Hitchcock had a particular gift for making himself quotable. He knew how to handle the press.
Yes.
And he was fond of saying that. In fact, he was always considerate and gentle with his cattle.
You were to work?
I never heard him humiliate an actor ever, quite the contrary.
You still kept a foot in the theatre. You couldn't get often to New York, so you brought your own theatre to the West Coast.
Yes, with a couple of cronies, Dorothy McGuire and Mel Ferrer, we began a summer repertory operation down in La Jolla, my hometown.
Yeah.
They happened to have a nice little theatre there. And for 6 years we went down and we produce all the plays ourselves, and we each appear at least once each summer. And it was quite good. We did quite good work down there.
Yes, some very distinguished productions, I've told.
The opening bill in 1947 was Dear Old Dame May Whitty Night Must Fall.
Uh-huh.
And she did it extremely well. She'd played it many times
before. Yeah, she played it in London, I think, didn't she?
She did. Mm. And I remember going to her apartment in Hollywood and telling her our story of beginning a new summer rep in Southern California. And I don't know why, but I guess it was my youthful sincerity and total ignorance. I seemed to appeal to her, and she agreed to come down and do it, and we went on from there.
It's time we had another record, number 4.
Let's have Symphony number 40 of Mozart, just because it's Mozart.
The opening of the 40th Mozart Symphony in G minor, the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Karl Böhm. Now, you were collecting a number of Oscar nominations. You got that first one for The Keys of the Kingdom, then another for Gentleman's Agreement, and yet another for an adult war film you made, 12 O'Clock High, which created quite an impact. But you get no credit at all for turning down High Noon. Now, how did that happen?
Well, it was a mistaken judgment on my part. I had made a film called The Gunfighter,
yes,
which even today remains one of my favorites. And several weeks later, a producer by the name of Stanley Kramer sent me the script of High Noon. And I recognized that it was a fine script. There was no doubt about that. But in my mistaken sense of youthful idealism, I thought, well, I didn't want to repeat. It had to do with the traditional loner who faces the whole town alone and puts his life on the line for what he considers to be what's right. And I thought, well, they're too much alike, and I would like to be versatile. And that was a great mistake, because I did turn it down, and Gary Cooper immediately accepted when it was offered and went on to do it with enormous success and won the Oscar doing it, as well he should, because he was perfect in it. I doubt that I would have been nearly as good. I could have played the role, but no one could have played it any better than Gary Cooper played it.
Have you enjoyed Westerns?
I did, up to a point. I made 10 or 12, and believe it or not, back in 1950, I was voted the outstanding Western Star of the Year. And I think somewhere in my basement I have a pair of silver spurs to prove it. But I didn't want to go on and on doing that. They don't talk much, for one thing. Mm. They're always taciturn, and they haven't much to say, and for good reason, because most of those Western characters were only semi-educated.
Correct.
and they weren't very conversational. And it gets a bit monotonous to be out somewhere in, let's say, Gallup, New Mexico, and have two or three lines to say a week.
Right. But you enjoy writing. You like all
that. I like the writing part of it. That's always been part of my life. And I do like the form. It's a classic American film form. But I think it's a bit out of style now. At least maybe the cycle will come round again.
I hope so. You've made several good sea stories. Captain Horatio Hornblower, R.N., was an excellent film.
Yes, I enjoyed making that. That was my first film in England, by the way.
Was it?
Back in 1950 out at Denham, with the great Raoul Walsh directing.
And Moby Dick. There's a terrifying story in a book which has been written about you by Michael Friedland, with the explanatory title Gregory Peck, about you being adrift on a rubber whale.
Well, it's true enough. We were attempting to film Ahab in the last throes on the back of the great white whale, entangled in the ropes of many harpoons that had been plunged into this beast. And the whale was actually 85 feet long. It was made of some rubberized material. It was a kind of a dirty gray-white. Underneath was the hull of an old potato schooner, I believe. And the tow rope broke in a sudden gale that blew up, and sudden seas. The waves were perhaps 12, 14 feet high, and the fog rolled in. And suddenly I was alone. Moby Dick and I were alone in the Irish Sea, and it was rather dicey there.
How far off the coast?
We were 8 or 9 miles out, and it was so foggy that I had no idea which way to swim, whether to swim for Ireland or for Wales. And it was slippery there. I didn't have a very good hold on him. And it did actually cross my mind that I might die there. And I began to get a queasy feeling in the stomach, and a kind of lassitude, which I'm told comes along with the physical fear, began to overtake me. But then the thought of the headlines really overcame the fear. Movie actor dies on rubber whale in Irish Sea.
Yes.
And so I began to shout and to yell, and finally I attracted the from the sound of my voice, they were able to find their way through the fog to the whale, and I gratefully slid down the side of the whale into a motor launch.
That was a very horrible experience. Let's have some more music.
This is a Pavarotti. Your Tiny Hand is Frozen. The remarkable aria from Puccini's La Bohème.
Con voi pur ora e i miei sogni.
Luciano Pavarotti, Your Tiny Hand is Frozen, from La Bohème. Another film of yours, Gregory, that looked highly dangerous was The Guns of Navarone. Was that risky?
Now and then you have a narrow escape or a little brush with danger. I've broken a leg in the process of making a Western film, and I've wrenched this and that. But for a very good and practical reason, our doubles do most of the really dangerous things, because can't have a $7 million film and have your star sent off to the hospital or to the mortuary in the middle of it. So actually we face very little real danger. But Guns of Navarone was a good, rousing adventure film, one of the ones that I enjoyed making and enjoyed watching, and I think people still do.
At long last, after all those nominations, you did get your Oscar for a film called To Kill a Mockingbird. What was the part? There's one I didn't see.
It's a very American story, and it's a small-town southern lawyer, a widower with two children, the only lawyer in town, and he risks his standing in the community, and even, in a way, his safety and that of his children, by defending a black man falsely accused of rape. And in the early 30s, it was, I'm sorry to say, totally impossible, unknown, for a black man to be acquitted on such a charge. But I did give him a spirited defense, and although he was found guilty, it was a dramatic trial and a dramatic story. And there was one marvelous moment, I think, that I always enjoyed. And I was leaving the courtroom after having lost the case, and my two children were in the gallery. And as I left and gathered my portfolio together and walked down the main center aisle of the courtroom by myself, the man in the gallery said to my two children, "Stand up, children, your father's passing." And that was a nice moment.
A very nice moment. Yeah. You set up a production company yourself. Did you enjoy handling that side of things?
Not much. I found that to produce a film takes about a year out of your life. I enjoyed the creative side of it, working with the writers, working with the editors, working with the director and the actors. But the business side, what they call the below-the-line side, yeah. I found terribly boring, long, long days in the office, and I missed the excitement of being on the floor with the camera and the crew and the actors. So I produced a couple of films, not particularly successful, and was off the screen for 3 years, and then I decided I'd rather get back where the real fun is.
Number six we've got to.
We have the first movement of Beethoven's Violin Concerto with the redoubtable Isaac Stern.
An excerpt from the first movement of the Beethoven Violin Concerto, Isaac Stern, with the New York Philharmonic, conducted by Leonard Bernstein. These days, a film actor is a gypsy. There's very little studio work anymore. You go to the actual location. You've done a fair amount of globe trotting.
Indeed, I have. This recent film was done in Goa.
The Sea Wolves.
The Sea Wolves, indeed. I never thought I'd be in Goa, but I found myself in Goa for 11 weeks and enjoyed it very much.
Yes.
I filmed in Ceylon, in Taiwan, in Ecuador, Mexico, most everywhere.
Yes, all expenses paid.
Yeah.
Well, going back to The Sea Wolves, which I enjoyed mightily, a lot of old sweats in it, David Niven, Trevor Howard, and a true story, of course.
It is a true story, based on a little-known exploit. The British put a German transmitter out of commission in neutral Goa back in 43, and that story was never told because of the sensitivity of the Portuguese. Well, that had to be done. We had to win that war, certainly. And the German U-boats were sinking Allied cargo vessels right and left because of this hidden radio transmitter, which was giving them pinpoint accurate information. Couldn't send in the Marines or the Air Force. It was determined that we'd send in a group of civilians. And they were an overage group, a club from Calcutta called the Calcutta Light Horse, named after a one-time active regiment in the Boer War. So these middle-aged types were only too eager to get into it and do their bit, and they trained up a bit and shaped up a bit and went and did this in a rather clumsy and sometimes comical fashion, still pulled off this commando raid, and it's quite a nice story, I think, and it's all true, and Mountbatten himself knew of it and was glad that the information finally could be released and that these old chaps could get some of the credit for that deed.
Record number 7.
This is Arthur Rubinstein, Chopin, the Fantasy Impromptu.
Chopin's Fantasy Impromptu in C-sharp minor, played by Arthur Rubinstein. Now, to a man who's been adrift on a rubber whale, a desert island must seem pretty humdrum. Could you manage? Are you a handyman?
Well, I'm handy around the garden, and that's the only way. That's the only manual skill that I have. This desert island of yours, I presume that edible things grow there.
There's everything there that you need if you can find out how to handle it all. Could you put up a shelter?
I think I could manage that.
Small craft? Do you know anything about it? Navigation?
Is there one?
No, you'd have to make a raft or something of the sort. Would you try to escape or would you sit it out?
I think I'd sit it out.
I don't blame you.
Not much confidence in my navigational abilities. No, I think I'd sit it out. What else am I allowed to have there? My wife, no.
No, you're on your own.
No pets?
No.
Books?
Well, I'm going to offer you one book, apart from the Bible and Shakespeare and big encyclopedias.
Well, I think I'd choose Sandburg's Lincoln. It's not one book, it's 6 books.
It's a good long read.
The first two are the prairie years, obviously the boyhood and youth of Lincoln, and the last 4 are the war years, having to do with his presidency and the Civil War. And I'm a Civil War buff and a Lincoln buff. Mm-hmm. And I find those books endlessly fascinating, and I often do pick them up. And not only do I enjoy them, but on nights when I'm troubled by insomnia, after a half hour or so of Lincoln or the Civil War, invariably I doze off. So there's a double purpose there.
Thank you. Let's have your last record. You've got one more disc to choose.
Well, my last three have been chosen because they're all by, I'm happy to say and proud to say, by friends of mine, Isaac Stern and Arthur Rubinstein, and particularly Mr. Sinatra. And I've chosen his version of New York, New York. And I think it's quite remarkably energetic, and I think he's taken over this song and made it his own. And he and I are contemporaries. I've known him since he was a skinny nightclub singer in 1941 in New York, and I was a brand new actor in town. We've met at that time. And I just think that he puts this song across with all of the energy and the gusto and the spirit of American popular music at its best.
Start spreading the news, I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it. New York, New York. These vagabond shoes are longing to stray right through the very heart of it, New York, New York. I want to wake up in a city that doesn't sleep and find I'm king of the hill, top of the heap. These little town blues are melting away. I'll make a brand new start of it in old New York. If I can make it there, I'll make it anywhere. It's up to you, New York.
Frank Sinatra, New York, New York. If you could choose just one disc.
I didn't know you were going to do that to me.
You've lost seven.
I'll take the Beethoven Seventh Symphony.
The Beethoven Seventh Symphony. And one luxury to have with you. Nothing of any practical use. Something to enjoy.
Not Sophia Loren.
I'm afraid it has to be inanimate.
Well, I would think of a packet of seeds so that I could garden, which is my only real skill that I have. But I'd also think of perhaps a crate of a Lafitte Rothschild 67, if you could throw in a nice brie. Do you think you could manage that?
Well, yes, just a taste of brie might be in the case. We'll give you more than one case.
Will you?
Yes, you might be there for quite a while.
Oh, that would make life very agreeable. Then I'll take the Lafitte Rothschild.
Right. And thank you, Gregory Peck, for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Thank you, and as the sun sets, I'd like to say I've enjoyed being on your desert island very much.
Thank you. Goodbye,
thank
everyone.
You.